I see they brought the breakout, the Danish, so I won't be long. So, I do hands-on restoration, among other things, and I'm going to show you about some new treatments we're working on. You've seen some pictures of slates, which are found from up here all the way down to South Carolina along the coast. They can be in excellent condition. The one on the right is over 300 years old. Perfect, practically. Very good. But these slates, when they get into problems with delaminations, can be very, very challenging, more challenging than sandstone. There's examples on the left of three different kinds of, you know, opening up. There's a picture there of an old epoxy in the top failing. Water's going to get in there, snow's going to get in there, ice is going to get in there, and over the course of time, they're going to pop apart, like the one on the right. I think someone mentioned about the heat and on the stones is going to cause them to move. Historically, the one on the left, it has a wonderful lead cap put onto it. It's actually a sandstone, which is delaminated. The ones on the right were in that same cemetery that Martha was just showing you. Unfortunately, they drilled holes right through the stone to keep that copper cap on. It did hold the stone together. And I understand squirrels love to eat lead. The one on the left is lead capped. So these things are slowly disappearing. The price of copper is causing these copper pieces to disappear. And then you've got this type of work set into either concrete or granite. It's kept the stone there. Historically, it's there. Aesthetically, it's a problem, but the stone is there. It's going to stay there for 1,500 years. And I think you saw one of these pictures up in Provincetown. There's actually 10 of these slates set into granite, probably done 50, 70 years ago. Somebody asked me why or how that happened. Did they all break? Most of the stones, let's say there's maybe 500 stones in that Winthrop Street Cemetery in Provincetown, probably 70 to 80% are slate. And only this group, there's six pictured here, but there's 10 in the group, are in the granite. They couldn't have all broken off at ground. I don't know why they're put in there, but they're put in there. They're going to be in there. They're going to last pretty much forever, more than anything else we could do. But aesthetically, today it'd be also very costly. I come across some old patches. They're not mine. On the left-hand side, there's some kind of epoxy mix that has been there. They've been there for maybe 20 years, and they've worked. They're usually on very thick slates, which are not moving too much. Maybe they've moved and they've stopped. Picture on the right had a epoxy fill to it, which had failed, and this is what you get. And eventually, these things are going to completely come apart and be delaminated. So quite a while ago, we started monitoring. I had this one big, thick slate with many big delaminations that you can see, which I could monitor the movement on it. And on the left-hand side is a digital laser thermometer, which I could record the temperature of the side of the stone in the sun, the side in the shade, the difference in the temperature, and I would monitor how much it moved. If you look carefully, there's little scribe marks on the slate, so I knew where to put the micrometer every day to measure the same distance. And it moved. So when you have something moving, and we're going to fill the inside of it with a cementitious material which does not move, you got a problem. We could put it in the granite. So we started experimenting with different fills. One of the problems that we ran into was we found a wonderful product about 12 years ago, and then it was taken off the market. And it was a flexible epoxy. But epoxies have got their problems. So here I am, was in 2008, and I'm applying two types of fillers, a cementitious one, basically a lime cement mix, and a hardware latex caulk mix, which I pigmented. And I'm putting in a backer rod. A backer rod is it's a flexible, kind of plasticky kind of, comes in different diameters to put the fill against. It doesn't stick to it. The caulk doesn't stick to it, the cement doesn't stick to it. So it can be removed if you want to remove it, or you leave it in place. But you can pack your caulking and your cement mix up against it. So there on the right-hand side, I've filled different voids with either the cementitious mix or a pigmented latex caulk. And now, you can see it. Great, it's really big. I'm going to go over here. 4 months after, how do you put this? It must be up here. How do you put the laser? Oh, I see it, this button. Ah, ha, ha. Okay, cementitious caucus, fill, it's all coming apart here. This gap from here to there has opened up even more, and it's now coming apart. We're down below here with this gray latex. There's nothing coming apart. That was 4 months afterwards. And now a year later, we've got some big gaps in the cementitious. And this is what we've been using all along. This or epoxy we kind of tend to stay away from. And the bottom image a year later, still tight. And looking pretty good. These are blown up quite a bit. Maybe they stay here. Ah. So but there's no, as we heard earlier, there's no one solution for this problem. There are many, many solutions, and maybe they're not the right solutions. We don't know yet for long term. But we've got different kinds of breaks here. Just eroding on the side, it's all opened up on the side. One big giant break, very, very thin break, and there's a stone that's completely delaminated. That's what's going to happen to all of them unless they're looked after. Ah, good. So there's basically, there's more than three ways to do it, but I'm going to show you three different ways that we've been doing it and monitoring all along. As the title says, I can apply a filler without filling the void. I just, all around the edge, fill it with either a cementitious fill or the caulk. They put a backer rod in first, and then I'm filling it, cleaning up the edges. I usually leave down at the bottom some weep holes, just in case water does get in the top, it can get out. And then you can fill the interior void, which I would prefer to do. Someone's going to ask me, when do you decide what to do in which stone? I don't have a good answer for that. It's kind of a gut feeling of how big the void is and what's happening. But we've gone along. This is a pourable grout. It's a hydraulic lime grout. It's a very weak strength. And it likes to, it's called a fluid one. It actually likes to pour. Hopefully I can show you that. But here I've either got a backer rod along the edge, or sometimes I fill it first, the edges, and then I can pour. But I have to contain this liquid. And there I am pouring. If this movie works next door, I'll show you. This stuff likes to flow. It likes to move. And I've put in quarts or gallons of this material. Oh, wrong one. Ah, it does work. And it just likes to move. It likes to flow down. This is actually a brown sandstone, but it had a better movie than the one I did for the slate. But you see it coming out. Whoops. Ah, damn. Darn, sorry. It won't work again, will it? Okay. This one. You see it coming out here. It's just flowing, 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 and going down this crack. It's going all the way down to the bottom of this stone, which is about 3 feet tall. And if it leaks out, there's a backer rod. That's what it looks like, plastic. Sometimes I like to see it leak out at the bottom. I know it's gone all the way. Then I can fill it up. This goes on for about a half an hour, so usually, no. It'll stop. Okay, good. This is a stone I was working on last year. You can see the epoxy fill up here that was done I don't know how long ago. I'm guessing 15, 20 years ago. I don't know. Epoxies have been around more than 30-something years. And here I'm taking it off slowly. I've opened it up completely. And now here I've started patching it but left it open so I can pour my grout in. Incidentally, I do all this work on site. And again, it's just a way of the highest points on this stone are here and on top of this curb. So I'll pour into here, and then when that's filled, I'll cap it, and then go up top and pour into here. So we started, in the beginning, we just used a latex caulk you'd find in the hardware store. Then we finally went to a more professional grade caulk. This is made by Stowe. They make products for fixing bridges and highways and buildings. It's not a commercial. It's more of a professional grade crack fill. Before you write the name down and eager to buy it, the other hardware store caulk costs between $4 and $7, you're looking at $40 to $60 for one tube. But it works. It works very well. And here I am mixing some pigments in it. It comes out gray. And I'm mixing it in to get a different kind of color. Cleans up with water. It's actually relatively easy to work with. And there I am tooling it on the right. There's pictures of the backer rod, which are behind that. If it's a wide gap, you put a backer rod in. This button. Tooling it, fixing it up, and filling it up with water. And if you pigmented it properly, it looks pretty good. Actually, it's pretty hard to see. You can see. Okay, here's a good one. 2008, 4 years later, you're starting to, this wide piece that was filled with latex was certainly too big for that latex to fill. And it's starting to tear in the middle. Okay? So I'm now discovering if it's that big, put in a cementitious fill. But over here is a detail of the stove product, and here it is down here. You see that area? Kind of muddy. Looks different. This is blown up tremendously. And I think there's a little area up here I filled. But basically, to the casual passerby, you don't see it. And I've got some series of befores, 4 years later, of all pigmented. This is in the same cemetery that Martha mentioned, the Amherst Cemetery in Amherst, Mass. And other ones? I'm obviously showing you the better ones, but no, but they actually, surprisingly, they look pretty good. It's hard to take exact before and after photographs, but this one's pretty good. That curve is right here, and you can kind of see the something here, but only because I'm pointing it out. And we'll be monitoring these. I'm not saying this is the end-all, be-all, but it seems to be the way to be going with something that moves with the slate. Otherwise, it's going to open up and we get the same problem. And that's it. See? Quick.